How large was Ancalagon the Black? This is a question I see almost every time the dragon is mentioned. Just like when Tom Bombadil is mentioned, someone will ask, "What is he?" Or when Balrogs are mentioned, someone will ask, "Do they have wings?" Discuss the mightiest of Morgoth's dragon host, and the destruction of the towers of Thangorodrim, and someone will ask, "Well, just how big was he?" In this video, I will answer this question in a way where it is left up to the reader to imagine the arrival and destruction of Ancalagon, without the need to settle on measurements or figures. For some background, Ancalagon, meaning rushing jaws or possibly biting storm, was the greatest of the winged dragons released from Morgoth's citadel, Angband, by the Dark Lord, at the end of the War of Wrath, set against the host of the Valar. After Ancalagon and the dragons initially drive back the host, Erendil the Mariner and his ship Vingalot, and a Silmaril upon his brow, fought with Ancalagon, slaying the dragon. The enormous peaks of Thangorodrim that towered above Angband were then destroyed in his ruin. Now, much like depictions of the Dark Lord Morgoth in his battle with Fingolfin, I personally think Ancalagon's size is maybe grossly overstated by most. Images are spread showing the dragon, Smaug, looking like a common lizard next to Ancalagon. Quotes over the years have circulated stating that he was large enough to cover the sun with his wings. Images are the result of reading a very brief text given to us from a mythological legendary conflict in a way that perhaps is far too literal. The quote I mentioned is one person's interpretation that managed to infect many Tolkien wiki sites without any citation or justification. Here is what we are told about Ancalagon. Then, seeing that his hosts were overthrown and his power dispersed, Morgoth quailed, and he dared not to come forth himself, but he loosed upon his foes the last desperate assault that he had prepared, and out of the pits of Angband there issued the winged dragons that had not before been seen. And so sudden and ruinous was the onset of that dreadful fleet that the host of the Valar was driven back. For the coming of the dragons was with great thunder and lightning and a tempest of fire. If we are going to get technical, then I think that Ancalagon must have been small enough to be set loose from Angband. We know that Angband itself was colossal, but if Ancalagon was as big as many believe, then it would make Angband even larger than described. He would have to fit in some pit or cavern that was so incomprehensibly huge that it makes the idea of him being some hidden secret underground ridiculous. I once read someone estimating that Ancalagon would be larger than the city of Tokyo. From east to west, Tokyo is about 56 miles, and 16 miles from north to south. This was calculated based on the theorised height of Thangorodrim, which he destroys. This whole process seems like madness to me and completely illogical. A strange way to dissect the legendarium into scientific calculations and values. An unofficial atlas says the peaks were 35,000 feet tall, leading others to say his wings must have been 15 miles wide to carry him. Why? An object does not need to be the same size or greater than another object to destroy it. Just imagine what destruction Ancalagon could cause if he had been that size. Why fate? Just fall onto the host of the Valar. Erendil would have been like a dust mite poking at the side of such a behemoth. Of course, one argument that could convince me that Ancalagon was so massive would be to turn my stance on Tolkien's work as mythology against me. Thor is able to battle the world serpent, Jormungandr, said to be large enough to circle the world and grasp its tail. Few debate how this is possible, because we're viewing a tale of mythology and legend. Couldn't Ancalagon be such a massive dragon that we should just accept this as a legendary tale spread by those within Tolkien's stories? Possibly, but I'd lean more towards that explanation if we were talking about other versions of Tolkien's work, when Turin was set to slay Ancalagon, as told in the prophecy of Andrith. The ending of the world, the last battle known as Dagor Dagorath. This obviously feels more like Ragnarök. But even the fantastical War of Wrath seems more grounded than what was planned for Dagor Dagorath. Still, if this is your position on the size of Ancalagon, that is completely up to you and your reading of the text. But many cling to sizes based on his destruction, and I want to attempt to put that idea to bed here by providing quotes about other creatures who manage to destroy what they land on when they die. Durin's Bane, the Balrog killed by Gandalf the Grey in The Lord of the Rings, and Smaug, the dragon killed by Bard the Bowman in The Hobbit. I threw down my enemy, and he fell from the high place and broke the mountainside, where he smote it in his ruin. The tower behind was crumbled into dust, the window gone. The ruined stair was choked with burned and broken stone. Full on the town he fell, his last throes splintered it to sparks and gleeds. The lake roared in, a vast steam leaped up, white in the sudden dark under the moon. There was a hiss, a gushing whirl, and then silence. And that was the end of Smaug and Esgaroth, but not of Bard. Was Durin's Bane the size of the mountain he broke, or the mountainside? Of course not. Was Smaug the dragon the size of Lake Town? I'd hardly think so. No one ever seems to make these claims about Durin's Bane or Smaug. So why do it for Ancalagon, falling onto mountains that were massive piles of slag? Just dust and waste. It is entirely possible that Smaug destroyed Lake Town in his death throes, and the same could be said of Ancalagon. Or you can choose to read descriptions as colourful language, used to convey heroic deeds, and the ferocity and power displayed. Smaug falls onto Lake Town in anguish and violence. Durin's Bane and Ancalagon are thrown down and cause devastation. Great foes destroyed by heroic figures. When a knight slays a dragon, do we examine just how he managed to physically kill it? Or is it the deed and heroism we discuss? Let's be conservative and say Ancalagon was between the size of the largest of all dragons, yet smaller than Tokyo. I think that's easy for most to accept. I'd rather not accept he was miles in size, but large enough, at least in the tales, to give the host of the Valar pause, arriving in a tempest of fire and storm to change the tide of war in Morgoth's favour, but also small enough to fly, to move, to suffer damage and death. He would have been enormous, unseen before, an impressive beast worthy of myth, but small enough for Arendil to challenge in Vingolot. The language used demonstrates power and the devastation of his defeat, causing its destruction to be sung in songs and tales about the conflict to end the First Age. His size is less important when his death signals the end of Morgoth's power and dominance, as Ancalagon falls and destroys the peaks of the Dark Lord's kingdom.